The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined by a returning guest about a year to the day this goes out as well, which is amazing timing. I'm joined again by Harmony Skye. Welcome to the show.
Hello. Thank you for having me back.
Again. Well, you were such a good guest last time that I thought when I was going through my list for season three, and I was getting some new guests, well, getting guests back on, like another couple hours with Scotty Swift. I thought, right, the last 12 months since we chatted has just been a bit nuts for you. A little bit.
It has.
So why not just get a wee catch up exactly a year from then? And yeah, when I was doing my notes, like I said, just before we hit record, last time it was a bit difficult to get notes because there was no wrestling. You hadn't wrestled yet. And really, I was interviewing you because Abby told me, you have to interview her. You have to interview her now. So I was like, okay, cool, we'll do it. And we did 40 minutes of a really good chat. And I was listening to her earlier. But now we can actually speak about you wrestling, which...
Wrestling stories.
It's quite exciting. So since our last chat, what was that? We went out November 2020. How was your training been from that point? Was it just keep going? Because at this point, was it online seminars you were doing?
Or? Yeah, it would have been. I think because we came back for a couple of months, but then we had to close off again. I'm sure. So I can't remember exactly when we came back, but I think it was still a couple of months after that. And then it was just kind of like, although we had to get in small groups and then eventually got to big groups and now we're back in proper classes, it was still very get everything in. It was probably more intense in the smaller groups because we had more time for everybody to have turns, so it was actually harder in the smaller groups. So
I was checking through the FPWA site, just to their Facebook, just to see who were on these online seminars, and geez, the names are pretty decent. So ones I picked out, which probably most of them would be Nick Aldis. I'm assuming you went to most of these, or all of the online seminars, if you could. Cool, that's fine. I don't want to start riffing off names. You go, no, I didn't go to that one.
I'm pretty sure I went to all of them, from what I can remember.
So we had Nick Aldis, Dean Allmark, Mark Andrews. So really, Andy's really got out the little black book and has pulled in all these names. And one that really jumped out was Carmel Jacob.
Yeah.
Of course, which... who just like finished up just before this whole like proper women's revolution. That's such a horrible phrase to use, but when we started this influx of high caliber women's talent, was there anyone in particular, like Carmel or Mark Andrews, anyone in particular that you took a lot away from, or was everyone just like you took a little bit from each?
I mean, I'd say probably the female ones like Carmel, and then we also had Viper or Dewdrop or whatever she's going to be nowadays, which was, I think that one was probably my favourite because I got in as much questions about things that only females could answer females. It was kind of stuff like how to deal with like sexist comments and stuff, and she was just kind of like, you will deal with them, but you just have to kind of push it to the back of your mind. And I think I came a lot away from that. Like I told her one time, one of my PE teachers said I couldn't be a wrestler because I didn't kind of do the splits, which doesn't make any sense at all. But I told her that, she was like, you'll get people that say comments like that to you all the time, but you know what you're doing and you can, it's for a reason. So just kind of keep that to your mind and push everything else to the back, which is really good to take away. So
I'm worried about what wrestling your PE teacher's watching, if that's the...
I mean, I don't know. That was when I was like 13 as well, but I don't care what kind of stuff you've been watching. I don't care, maybe Melina or something.
Maybe. That's a wholesome way to put it. Yeah, probably Melina. Not in something for Clips for Sale or something weird. So Viper, of course, that's a great role model to have as well when it comes to wrestling, because you know she's you see her nearly every day on Twitter, either with something positive, some positive reinforcement, not just for women, but for just anyone. She's really took advantage of her being on Raw and actually in the WWE system to like use that power for good, and giving the likes of yourself and everyone else something to work upon and able to, like I said, give that positivity out there. So we've got here mainly training, of course, FPWA still, but you're starting to make your way around the whole booking world of world wrestling in Scotland anyway. We'll just jump into it. Your ICW debut. When did you know? Yep. How did you find out? Or did you have your gear ready? Just everything about that debut.
Luckily, I'd have bought gear before, so I had my gear from maybe a couple months before that, and I was like, I just in case I needed to get something, which was luckily in favour for me. So I got a text. I remember that week, a week after wrestling, because I was feeling quite stressed. So I texted Andy. I was like, I'm not going to be coming in this week. ICW films on a Sunday. He texted me on a Wednesday saying, I can't have like a rest week, but I really need you to come in. And I was like, I reckon what he's wanting. Like, I just, maybe ICW was in the back of my mind, but I was like, surely no. Like, I've not even wrestled yet. I got there, he turned me into the office, so I was like, oh God. And my dad was there as well. He was like, so we do want you to have your debut at the student showcase, whenever that will be. But how about we have it earlier, as on Sunday? And I was like, God, what's he talking about? And he was like, for ICW. And I was like, yep, of course. So I only had a couple of days to plan, and I had my theory test that week. I had my theory test on the Friday, so I didn't actually have any time to kind of process that I was going to be there until I was standing outside of the asylum. And it was just great. It was great to be there. It was a quick match, but it was something to get me in the door and to kind of meet people. We had Jack Jester, who was my agent for my match, who was giving me such like great feedback after the match. We had to go first because Emily Hayden had to get a bus in and her bus was going to be late. So we had to go first, which also didn't really give me much time to be like, oh my God, like I'm going to wrestle the new. So got out there, done that, and then after that was like, oh, I was pretty all right. Yeah, like I actually done quite well. So it was a good debut, and especially for it being on the WWE Network, which is like crazy. I could watch myself by going on the WWE app. It was just like mental. To me.
So, like you say, you didn't have time to really think about it. So, yeah, Wednesday, you maybe had maybe the evening, and then Friday, you were too busy thinking about other things. And then the glamorous world of wrestling, you had to go first because Emily's bus, had to get a bus. So, it's not
all
quite
very
the.
Quick.
Yeah, absolutely. So, when it came to your. When I was listening to our last show, I was laughing at your dad's creative ideas. And how you run past everything by him. And you just mentioned him there, being there for being told you're making your debut. Your gear, though, so it's very like it's continuing that hippie theme, the flower power, peace and love kind of thing. How much was his input into that? Was he well into?
I do think he had as much input as he does everything else. But I don't think. What do you think about this pattern? Like, we've got a bunch of patterns sent. I wanted to have like a sort of like tie-dye effect, which is on the gear, but we had a bunch of patterns and I was like, oh, what about this one? And he was, I like that one. But then he's already hanging me like different gears. He's like, we have to get a white one for like when you be heel, or we have to get this for when you like when you're older. I'm like, oh my God, like I'm just buying my first gear. So we always kind of knew that I wanted to have the flares and kind of the hippie vibe, so he didn't have as much input, but he's already hanging about like the next set and me being heel when God, that's not even going to happen for at least a couple of years.
So it's very different gear, though, because of course a lot of wrestlers, just everyone nowadays either has like just a singlet or they have quite like spandexy tight gear, and this is very different, very flamboyant. Yep. Was that the intention, like so just either to stand out, or was just as soon as you saw flares, you're like, nah, I need that. Yeah, that'll be perfect for my character.
Yeah, I think it was probably a combination of both. Like I wear flares. Daily anyways, so I thought like we'll get something that I like, and then it was just kind of the part of, like I've never been somebody that's always liked to kind of show, so I didn't want someone really short, I didn't want someone like too high, so something that was, I always knew I wanted like long trousers, and then when the top kind of came a little bit longer to think about, because I did have I had like old gear as well, but that didn't really work out that well. So like the top was kind of just looks like a sports bra, and I was like, that's not really that nice. I didn't really like that. And I went, well, kind of texting back and forth, it was by JJ Creations that done my gear, which does like a lot of people that I've been seeing. So I went to them, and we kind of went back and forth, and we thought about putting the flares on the arms as well, which would be kind of cool. And it goes with a hippie vibe, and goes with like, just kind of like this. I was just all about that same vibe and taking parts from me and then making me feel comfortable in it, which was done very well.
So yeah, I did watch the match, and it was weird seeing it pop up on like social media and seeing the photo. I was like, oh my god! I only chatted to her a couple months ago. I think I was like, this is amazing. I was right. All the guys at FPWA were right to badger me just to go, right, you need to speak to her. Yep. I was like, okay, I will. I'm glad I did. Yep, now.
First interview.
Exactly.
So there you go.
When you're back on the network winning all these titles, I'll know I was the first one to interview you.
Hopefully.
But so of course you made your debut on the WWE Network, which is crazy in itself.
Yep.
You're probably maybe the second youngest person ever to wrestle on the WWE Network, I would say.
I don't know the ages, but I'm probably one of the youngest anyways.
Fortunately, Nicholas, he's kind of screwed it for everyone else. He was 11.
Does it really count, though, because he didn't actually wrestle?
He did win a WWE tag team title. So,
well, he's got that, but besides that, I'll take it.
Outside of that, you would be one of the youngest anyway. And so you said there was not a lot of time to think, but once, of course, you said it was a quick match with Emily. Once the bell had rung and all that had happened, was there a bit of a moment of relief going, or was there a bit more pressure going, oh my God, I've just done that and it's going to be on the WWE Network?
I think it was probably relief. I wasn't in so much pressure. I don't think I thought about being on the network until I realised, like, until it was out. And then Omar Muhammad texted me like, oh, is your match coming out this weekend? And I was like, is it? Like, I didn't even care what week it was coming out. So I think I didn't get too excited until I actually saw it. After my match, I stayed there for like 4 hours anyway, so I was kind of around like everybody, and we had like Molly Spartan and stuff. She was giving me a lot of advice, kind of taking me under her wing. There was a lot of women there. We had Angel Hayes, and I think we had all the women except for Ellie Armstrong, actually. I think she was the only person that wasn't there, so it was good. And I didn't realise it until I watched it, and I was like, oh my god, I'm on the WWE Network. Like, I was just mental to actually see that. I think that's probably when it hit me.
So how many places did your dad tell after it went up on the network? Was he sharing it everywhere?
Everybody. He always talks about me at his work, so everybody can. Like, my cousin just started at his work as well, so somebody went up to him and was like, oh, are you a wrestler as well? As if like we're a whole family of wrestlers, because he talks about it so much, but it's just me. But everybody.
And what did like your friends outside of this wrestling bubble, what did they think of you being on Peacock and could be 44 million people watching you? What did they find it a big deal? Were they like, oh, you're still doing the wrestling thing? And
Probably not. I didn't think they really bothered that much that I even do wrestling. It doesn't even digest to them that that's what I actually do. Like, I was showing one of my pals like promo pictures, and she was like, all right, okay. And I was like, well, you could see someone like, hello, I'm on the WWE Network, like try to rub it in, but they don't care. I mean,
it's too busy watching AEW or something, you know, just to so yeah, that was a huge, I mean, like I say, that's ICW, which was the last chat, that was a company you wanted to get to, along with like Fierce Females and what have you. Mm-hmm. So that's one ticked off already. I just had just the one match. I don't know if you've recorded more or you're booked for any future non-taping shows. I'll never find out until they actually come out on the network. But I'm sure you've got more matches in the future. But along with that, your training's just been, and again, you've been booked everywhere. But I want to speak about the FPWA opened up like a females' day. I think it's monthly. Oh, they do like an all females class.
Yeah.
How did you find that? Because of course you trained quite a bit with Ashley Vega, but this is bringing in like more so established names around the UK, around Scotland anyway. Because I see like Brody Adler and Anastasia and all that coming in. Did you find that was beneficial? You're able to mix up with people you'll likely be wrestling for the next who knows how many years.
It was really, really good to get as many females as we could, because the whole time, I mean, besides Ashley Vega, I've never really wrestled or trained with females before. And she doesn't really come down as often. So it's only me and kind of guys. So Andy kind of ran past it. He ran by me. And then he was like, what would you think about like a female class? Because he was kind of concerned about the fact that it's a male teaching a female class. And I was like, I don't think it matters. As long as we get all the females and together and like, well, it's kind of, it's just different when you wrestle with females compared to males. And there's stuff that we do differently. There's some, it's just different ways that we pick up each other, or even it's like the tiniest details. So it was really, really good to get everybody in. And we had like Sammy Jane and stuff come to the first one. And we had, you said, Bogie Adler. So it was really good to get to work with different females that I'd always kind of known and seen on like social media, but never met them yet. So it was good to actually get to speak to them and see them and kind of hear stories from them.
I suppose as well, I mean, if it was maybe anyone else at any other training school, maybe a little bit, oh, it's a guy, but it's Andy Wilde, who's now popping up in NXT UK every so often, and mm-hmm. so he's able to bring back that experience to you. Have you found that the training, as you said, it was a bit more intense because it was non-contact for a bit, but once he came back from NXT UK, was he bringing in even more? Were you finding out what WWE were looking for? You found the training stepped up because of it?
Yep, definitely. He always says, like, this is what I learned at the PC, without rubbing it in, but he's always kind of, anything he learns there, he's taking it back to us so we can only get a head start, whether it's, like, spots or little drills that we do. There's one where we're on corners and somebody's in the middle, he'll shout a number and you have to roll over that person. It's just, like, these things like that, which can blow you up really, really quickly. But it's good to actually get that feedback. And he spoke to people like Shawn Michaels and stuff, like, but like he's got like some good information, some good like feedback from literally the best that there's ever been. So it's good to actually get that back to us before we kind of go out there and hopefully get to NXT ourselves.
Absolutely. And then when you're doing the drills with Shawn Michaels watching via probably Zoom, as well, you can like go, I know what I'm doing, Shawn. You just sit back. I'll show you how it's done. So Andy seems to put a little bit of trust into you then, because he obviously approached you about the idea of this female class. He also took you on a little bit as a bit of the training for the beginners.
Yeah.
How did you feel when you were asked to do that? Were you thinking, whoa, I'm not ready for that? Or are you just jumping in, diving in both feet?
Well, it was kind of just someone to get me out of the house. It was like, just come along to the Monday class. And it was just there to kind of help out, just to go through spots and stuff. So he didn't have to take on as much on his body, because he does Monday, Tuesday, and then he goes to the kids class and he's there on Thursday. So he does like the whole week. So bringing me in, and then he slowly started transitioning me to a coaching kind of thing. He was like, thank you, this drill today. Like, he texted me a day before and he was like, thank you, this drill we're going to do it tonight. And I was like, oh my God, we're going to do a drill that I've. And I was like, right, we'll just call it the Harmony Finish, and we'll just hanky something that's going to blow them up really quick, but also put some stuff that they've been learning. So, yeah, we transitioned slowly but quickly into being just helping it to actually take on a mini coaching position, which was really good. It actually helped my confidence a lot, which is what he was trying to kind of do, because he speaks to us quite a lot about how coaching's helped his confidence. And he thought that I maybe needed like a wee confidence boost, which definitely helped.
Of course, and yourself, and I think Omar does quite a few for the kids one, the juniors and what have you. Yeah. So you guys have kind of formed this little FPWA mini team underneath Andy and of course Johnny Lyons, who since we've chatted, I was again listening to our last chat and I was scared about how intense my chat with Johnny would be, and yeah, that was over 2 hours, so I was right in thinking I would lose control of my podcast very quickly if I interviewed Johnny Lyons, and I did. So
he talks a lot, like he just rambles, but he speaks a lot of good stuff, but he still rambles a lot, but I'm used to it.
He's one of those where he's seen all the bad things that have happened just about in wrestling, so he's able to at least impart a lesson. Don't do this, don't work for free, don't do this, don't do that. So because he's done it, so he knows not to do it anymore. So in amongst the rambles, there's always a nugget of information, a nugget of gold that you can just go, right, that was a lesson. That was half an hour, but I've got a lesson out of it somewhere as well. So FPWA have just been super busy. You've been transitioning a little bit into a coaching role as well as making your debut. They also did the training camp, the weekend training camp. How was that for, was this just more of a, just another intense course, just 2 days of just pure getting everything done?
It was a lot, but it was really, really fun. We had 4 hours, it was 2 days, 4 hours each. So we were there for ages. And it kind of, the first day was a lot more intense. The first day was kind of about getting drills, and we weren't there to kind of blow us up. We just wanted to get someone to get us warm. So we done a lot of intense drills, and then it was a lot of, we had matches and stuff as well. I had a match with Ashley Vega. Second day was a lot more about character work. We just went straight in, got matches done, went through feedback, and then we done a whole promo type style thing. And it was like games that it seemed so ridiculous. Like, we talked about some stuff that's like, talked about like pooing your pants and stuff, like, and we'd turn that into a promo. It was really weird. Like, anybody outside, if they heard us speaking, they'd go, like, what are they talking about? But it was really fun. It was actually really, really cool. Speaking about pooing your pants, I'll not mention who, because that's maybe a bit embarrassing, but they talk about how they'd done that to themselves, and then he was like, you just told us a promo there because you've told us what happened, how you felt, where you were, and we're all like, oh my God. He did just do a promo, so we kind of taken all that information and just kind of ran with it. Just done like a quick, like, weird thing about poo. And then we done a promo where we could only say the word blah, but you had to use your facial expressions. And that was when Johnny Reeves had to get me to join his cult, but we were only able to say blah, which was really, really funny. I couldn't help but laugh. So I just kind of walked the wall for him, and it worked. But it was ridiculous.
Yeah, I didn't think I'd hear the word poo used so much in any podcast. And unfortunately, I probably just got a name in my head that, but just because it would sound funny to say, and I'm sorry, Omar, just because I've just got Pumar in my head. And that's just, I apologize in advance.
I will say it wasn't him, though.
That's fine.
He was in my group, but.
I think that's best to clarify, because the worst thing you could do is me just throwing out the name and then everyone just going, you shot yourself.
Yes, it was not Omar.
It was not. So yeah, that's one down. If you check the list, you can find out who it is eventually. Yep. Anyway,
it was not me either. It was not me. So you can go through the list now. Not me, not Omar.
So like I said, there's so many things that you've done training wise, and what was it like getting back, going from non-contact training for however long it was, then do the webinars? How was it back to actually full contact and getting thrown about again and bumps and actually getting into contact with someone? How was that after a prolonged break of not getting to do it?
It was really, really weird, because like just the slight things about maybe getting some of the coastline, we were all doing it, no wrong, but we were all doing it stuff to where we were like, we used to do this like perfectly before, and now we can't really do it now. And it's like, I remember we did take a video and put it on like social media for the first mock-up, which was just mental, like just to actually see two people making contact. That was crazy to just even be there. And then whole class, you were trying to go too stiff because you didn't know how hard you were actually hitting, knew that you'd not hit somebody for about a year and a half. So it was just weird that was really, really, really fun to actually get to hit somebody again in a nice way. But I was like, you didn't know if you were going too stiff, you didn't know if you were going too high on like clotheslines or stuff. It was just, it's like we were back at the beginning again because we hadn't done it for a year and a half.
So outside of, did you do anything else outside of like the web seminars and the non-contact? Were you just finding excuses just to watch a bunch of wrestling and take notes? Or what was your kind of, what did you do outside of FPWA for this last year until, of course, you've been able to get back into the ring properly?
Sorry, you froze for a minute, so can you repeat the question?
Oh, yeah, no bother. So I was just asking pretty much, outside of FPWA, what have you been doing in the last 12 months since we last chatted, outside of course wrestling and ICW, just how you've been keeping yourself occupied?
I've been crocheting, which I've been making myself a cardigan, and I started and then stopped for like 6 months, and then I'm starting again. And it's easier than I thought it would be, but it's like the arms are wonky, so one's like up here and one's down here, and it's stressing me. So I stopped for like 6 months, and then I'm back. I also bought a lot of pets, so now I've got 2 hamsters and 2 guinea pigs, which have been keeping me occupied for the time being, and they're literally right there, so I hope they don't make any noise. But I couldn't help it. I saw them and I was like, I really, really need that. Which probably not the best for my room because it probably smells like a pet shop. But
yeah, this interview is coming with a lot of surprises. Like I said, poo chat and crocheting was not that much. It was just, how did you pick that up? Was it just you started and you thought, oh, I'll give that a go? Or would you see like what I think Tom Daly was doing it at the Olympics? Was it something yep. just came into your mind, thought, ah, I'll give that a go?
It was the same thing about Tom Daly. It was Harry Styles wore this cardigan, and I love Harry Styles. He's somewhere on this wall. And I was like, I just wanted to try it. I wanted to have one for myself, but it's like a grand and a half. And I was like, oh, can I buy that? So I just thought I'd make it. And I've seen a lot of people on stuff like TikTok and Instagram making it. So I was like, how hard can it really be? And it's not that hard. So I just thought I'll get a try. It was visible. It wasn't hard until I started stitching it again. One arm's wonky and one arm's no. But I'm back again. I fixed it. So it's fine. I'm not done though.
It's fashion. I've seen all these things mm-hmm. on TikTok and that about fashion, and it's like could be anything. You can wonky arms. That's just fashion. you never know. Like when by this time this comes out, you might have finished it. It might still be a bit wonky, and you'll scroll through TikTok and Harry Styles is wearing a wonky jumper, and you're like, I'm already on top of this. and of course, I mean TikTok as well is still it's slowly. Again, since we last chatted, I didn't have TikTok, and now it's probably about 4 hours of my day just scrolling, mm-hmm. scrolling, yep. and it's there's nothing goes in. It's just scrolling through rubbish and TikTok dances, which I'll never do.
No, not for you either. I think I've done one, but I don't think I did post it, but it was one. I think it was the Savage dance, but I wasn't being serious about it, but the dance is more for me, like,
no dance. Stick to wrestling. Yeah, you stick to wrestling instead. Right, fair enough. Everything else, well, let's go through what's been announced then, and we can get your thoughts and opinions, because annoyingly, I think for both of them, the matches that have been announced, or one of them anyway, it'll happen by the time this has gone out, will be your Respect Pro Wrestling debut.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll be in the ring with Ruby Roberts and Ellie Armstrong, and you'll be teaming with Emily Hayden, who you wrestled mm-hmm. in your very first match. Yeah. So when the guys at Respect, was it Emily that kind of put your name forward? Do you know how you ended up making your debut at Respect?
I think it maybe was. I got a text from Bobby Roberts, and then Emily texted me, she was like, it's not something weird, like it's just Respect trying to book you in. And I think she said she mentioned my name a couple of times about my debut and how I carried myself really well. So I think I probably owe it to her for the booking, but maybe that's why we're teaming up, because she actually got me in there. But that's how I found it. He texted me at Facebook and I was like, I used to be a fan of like Bobby Roberts when he was like 100% Scottish beef. Like I was trying to get my dad to buy my t-shirt. I didn't actually get the t-shirt, but I was weird because now he's booking me for a match when I used to actually watch him when I was like, I think maybe 10, 11, which is real weird.
But maybe not open with that when you meet him. Just go, I used to wrestle when I was 10. I don't think you'll appreciate that as much.
maybe keep the age out. Maybe just be like, I used to watch you wrestle, and we'll leave it at that.
Yeah, so yeah, 100% Scottish beef, of course, as he's also famously known as Robert Roberts. I don't know if he's ever going to change that, because I'm seeing he's going down as like Big Nasty in some places. I don't know if he's trying to change it. Yeah, so I don't know if he's trying to change it up so people don't keep going, it's Robert Roberts, his name, his full name. But yeah, so Respect Pro Wrestling, of course, so they're bringing a lot we've got such a big kind of not booking team but a coaching team, like Luke and Sharp's in there as well, and they've got a little bit of a connection with W3L, Have you been able to get to Respect at all to see what their training's like and meet anyone else there?
I've not gone through yet. I'm hoping to get through eventually, and hopefully before the match happens, so we can kind of go through stuff. I know that Emily wants me to go through, so I think it'll just be about hopefully finding the time to actually go through. And I would love to go and see like what they're training at school or what it actually looks like, because I know they've got kids classes as well, I'm sure. So I think it would be fun to actually just like go and see and get to be in the ring before I actually have to wrestle. Rings are very different, and the ICW ring and ropes were very tight, and I had a couple bruises from my tag partner. But so I'll forget about that, and I'll be nice to her when I see her.
So you said, I don't remember us speaking about it before, but you said, so you've seen Bobby Roberts wrestle in the past. Did you, I mean, Krista's a big fan, as we've established. She's getting a lot of name drops in this
Yeah,
particular
Emmy, I'll
episode.
appreciate that.
So yeah, what kind, do you know what shows you went to? Was it SWA? Was it BCW? What kind of shows did you get to?
I think it was Reckless Intent from, that's the one that I remember the most, because my dad's friend used to wrestle there, and I remember it being Reckless Intent, and we had, well, Joe Hendry was there, and I called him a dick, but I'm not gonna say it. I meant it. I was really young, and I spent it with, like, the global hero. So when he shouted his name and put the mic out, I couldn't help myself. But I didn't mean it. I retract my statement. But Reckless Intent, we'll stop it there.
Rex Letang, yeah. So that must have been when he was champion. Was like 2015 or something like that. Something like he was champion then, and that would have been just hot off him being in popping up in WWE for his extra work as well. So I'm just laughing at you calling him a dick, just as however old you were, 12, 13 or something like that, just calling him a dick.
I think I didn't think I had any memory until my dad said it to me, and I was like, oh, maybe I did. That they can just getting right. That's probably when I knew, right, I have to get in there, because I could see it to his face. But
So I mean, because Ashley pops down so often, she of course trains in at Joe Hendry's school. Is there any been is that there's been temptation to try and get down to Edinburgh to wrestle there, or is that, or now that you've called him a dick, you're just like, maybe he'll remember that, and I might not want to go.
I hope he doesn't hear me saying that, although I have retracted my statement. I'm hoping to, maybe, I feel like it'd be good to go to as many training schools where there's other females, just to kind of, everybody has different information to give you, everybody has different feedback to give you. So it'd be fun, especially to kind of be in Ashley Vega's like territory and be in her training school. So I think eventually I probably will. I've not had any plans yet, but maybe next year at some point, I'm hoping, anyways.
Well, you trained for about, was it 4 years or something like that before you made your debut to a W3L and to at FPWA, and again, jog of my memory, Paramount, that whatever it was at Paramount, which I was looking for their Facebook page again because I was trying to find any results. Possibly I can get what matches you had, but they've deleted it, and I'm just gutted. I was just like, ah, oh, I remembered it for years, and then yeah, it's gone. So. Still making your debut in ICW, and like I said, just 4 years in, it's not too bad. Other place that you've been announced for, but your match hasn't been announced as of recording, is your Pro 2. You are Pro 2, and you'll be part of the, I think it's the, is it the Bell of the Brawl tournament? I think it
I'm not
is.
sure. Probably summer anyway. I'm not sure. Even the new, to be honest.
So Logan Storm, of course. I can, again, your dad's going to mention, I can see him as like your dad, because all I hear about
Logan,
is
keep
if he
teasing
books
for
you,
the
he
behavior.
comes with an idea. Oh, you hear me? Oh, you've frozen a little bit there.
Just
Hello?
saying. My internet is really, really bad. Right, they've gone back.
Okay,
You were
cool.
frozen again.
Right, that's fine. So yeah, I was just saying that Logan Storm usually comes with a booking, so I hear. with an idea. He doesn't book you for no reason. He usually comes with a pre-plan. So when Logan contacted you to be part of Pro 2 Wrestling, were you surprised? Do you know how that happened? Again, do you think it was Emily recommending you? How do you think you got there?
Well, I was actually Andy that told me that I'd gotten the booting, so I suppose maybe he put me forward for it, which is kind of how I got the ICW booting as well, which I'll take anything. So he messaged me, he was like, keep this day free, we're going up with us in a car with a bunch of other people, and you'll have a match. And I was like, cool, I'll take anything, especially if it being Pro 2, which is one that since the last time we filmed the podcast has been one that I've wanted to wrestle at, especially I've got quite a lot of good wrestlers there as well, so I'm happy to just be a part of it and just I'll take any match. I'm still not sure which kind of match it'll be. I'll probably find out when it gets announced, but I'm prepared for anything.
That's the thing, when I was speaking to Logan, he really put forward that not only is it Pro 2 a promotion that he runs, but he brings in so many people that can provide that opportunity for matches. So you got guys like you got Andy coming up, of course, which is an easy one because of course he's your trainer, so if bookings are going to come your way from him, that's not a surprise. But you've got guys like Frank Cross, who does Big Massive Wrestling, you've got Bobby, who does Respect Pro, you've got Looking Sharp, who wrestles quite frequently in Fair City as well. Mm-hmm. So it's like a nice wee hub of potential employers that can see your match and go, right, we'll book her for my next show and what have you. So is there anyone, have you had checked out the poster? Is there anyone in particular on there that you wouldn't mind getting the ring with? Or are you just happy to take any booking?
I'll take anything at this right now. I'll take anything. I mean, anywhere I get to wrestle, anywhere that wants me, I'll take it. I'm just happy to actually get out and actually wrestle in front of, I've never wrestled in front of a crowd yet, so I'm excited to just wrestle in front of people being there and cheer me on. I don't know if adrenaline will kick in differently if there's a crowd there, so I'm kind of excited to just see that aspect there.
So yeah, speaking of that, so of course your debut, it was on the WWE Network, again, 44 million people could have watched it, and it was in front of nobody though. So
no, nobody was there.
With all that kind of not being able to really think about it too much because of how it worked out time-wise, how did you find the match itself in front of nobody? Was it just feel like a training match to you because you're used to doing that? Or how did you actually feel about the match itself being in front of like no one except some camera crew and a referee?
I think I was probably more focused on there being cameras. Although there was no crowd, there were still cameras there, which is probably the opposite of me going to wrestle at other places like Respect and stuff. There won't be as big a camera crew with a huge cameras on their shoulders, so I think I was kind of focused on that aspect of it, being there, cameras there, where should I go, what side should I face, and I was just kind of thinking about that, so I didn't really have time to kind of be like, oh, there's like nothing here, and there was no seats, but that I knew where the people would actually go, so it was weird to see that when there was like nothing there. But maybe just imagine, hopefully going back to ICW when this crowd's there. I know the fans are insane there, so I mean, that's an insane championship wrestling, but I'd love to wrestle in front of ICW fans.
So how are you feeling about wrestling in front of a crowd? Because as I said, you're Andy kind of put you into this kind of coaching role to build up your confidence. So how are you feeling about wrestling in front of a crowd that might not know who you are? They're not a bunch of nerds like myself who know who you are and where you've trained and all that kind of stuff. So what's, how are you feeling about that?
I'm excited to just kind of let people know who I am, introduce myself to people that probably don't know who I am, and hopefully through the match they'll become a fan and like just kind of follow my career, hopefully. But I'm excited, but also I feel like it will add on to the nerves as like, what if I muck up anything? What if people like just then gravitate towards me? Just like all those wee things that I didn't have to worry about at ICW, because if I mucked up, then I didn't know that and nobody was really there. So, and there was nobody to, besides obviously like Matt Dallas and all that, there was nobody to impress in the crowd. Like if you get what I mean, like there was nobody to be like, oh, what if they didn't like me? But I guess I'll not find out until the day I actually step out and there's people there. But knowing fans, they'll probably cheer for me anyway, because I'm young and a face. So.
And then you've got the cool gear and everything like that.
The cool gear. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Absolutely. Can, if it all goes wrong, you can distract them with the flares. It'll be fine.
Yep.
But yeah, I think so many people are so excited to see wrestling again. I mean, I know myself, I went to my first show as of recording weekend before, I don't know. And people just want to see wrestling. They didn't care particularly who it was, but as soon as you come out and you're the good guy, if you're clapping, you do the whole classic, come on, everyone's just going to go, yep, I'm here for some wrestling. Let's fucking do it. Let's do some wrestling. So on one hand, it's going to be like trying to get people to like you. I don't think it'll be difficult for the first shows back anyway. But I think you'd have to do something very special to get them to stop clapping. But who knows? I might have just jinxed you there, to be honest. Sorry about that. By the time this comes out, your debut would have happened, so I'm sure it went well, and I'm not going to delete as appropriate, but good congratulations on the win. Commiserations on the loss. There we go. Delete
the
as
win,
appropriate.
Hopefully.
Exactly. So, question we asked everyone, of course, was the dinosaur question, which he answered, which is still my favourite answer of all time, which is the turkey dinosaur. I made it into my top five dinosaurs in that ridiculous list I did on the website. But we added another one since then.
Okay.
I don't know if you're aware of it. It's another stupid question that we ask everyone. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow.
A bigger. Fine. Yeah. That's all it is. That's the whole question. It's not
I
as
feel, I feel like,
intense.
I mean, there is two, but it's a lot bigger. Like, cows are heavy. It just could, like, sit on it and be done.
Fair enough. That's what I think, anyway. There's always two ways this is answered. Either someone will overthink it and want to ask more questions, or someone will just pick one and that's it.
Yep.
That's the segment over. And you went for the latter, so that's absolutely fine. We do have a question, though. We did get Omar. He messaged me. He asked just to ask you about Andy Wilde nicking your catchphrase on the FPWA online classes.
Yep. So whenever my catchphrase is peace, love, and harmony. So whenever we'd like the whole class was finished and he'd say bye, they'd always be like, right, peace and love. And then everybody would shout harmony, like before he'd hang up. Every time Omar would message me being like, can't believe you stole your catchphrase. I'm going to have to sue him because that's getting ridiculous. And I didn't think I clicked on it at first until it was probably Omar that messaged me being like, he just like said peace and love. And I was like, I can't, what's his deal with that? But it's funny that he still remembers that though, because I forgot about that. But it was a good wee joke. Every week we'd wait for him to say it and then we'd all kind of shout it. But it was great. At first I was like, what is his deal? But I'll let him have it for that time being as I wasn't using it.
Until he starts using it on NXT UK and you could be like, ha ha, oh no. This is mine.
I'm taking credit for that money. 20%, 50%.
At least, I think 60 is fair if you're gonna go for
it. I'll take all the credit.
So before we kind of start moving our way to the end, because like I said, we've rattled through these notes. We seem to just every time we chat, it's like it just gets quicker and quicker. Because like, yep, that's the answer. Yep, that's the answer. All good. what's it like seeing guys from FPWA popping up on things like the WWE Network? Like I think Omar was one of the first. You had Talon Jr.
Yep.
Most recently, I had Big Caleb, who joined the school a bit later from up here, from the Northeast. How cool is it seeing people in your school making it to the WWE Network and NXT UK, like Andy? And do you ask for their autograph when they come back?
It's crazy to see them. Like, it's, we had Talon, who bet, I'm not sure who beat, but he won and the cover. And we had Omar, who was the cover of it, and Caleb's just kept as well. He's been training with us for a couple months now, I think. And he was on the
Oh, lost you a second there.
I'm back. Oh, I think what happened there. I think it's my internet.
That's all right. You're talking about anyway, Caleb.
Yes. Caleb's been training with us for a couple of months, so we were all there kind of been nobody found do it but before he went, so we were like, oh my god, like he's gone nice and W, but she really, really deserves it. Like just even like he's ripped, like it's like I look at him and I'm like, oh my god, like how does he even, that doesn't make any sense, but how you could put that much muscle on. But being like, who was it that was it, that Talon vet, I can't remember who it was, but I remember him.
Well, Omar is going to be very disappointed because it was him.
I'm sorry. No, not Omar. I know he bet Omar, which I was like, oh, that one was really, really crazy to see, where we had two people from the school fighting each other on the network. It was just like, oh my god. And then we had Talon's for Andy, which was crazy as well, because it's like, that's his coach, like, and he's battering you, but which I guess Andy maybe did get the upper hand, considering he's taught us everything, so he can kind of how to get out of it and kind of get into it. I'm not sure who it was though, but everybody,
I'm just going by cage match, and that's the only one I've got is Talon winning, because he's further back. He's got a tag team match somewhere as well. So yeah, who knows? I'm sure he'll know.
I'm pretty sure he's fighting him again. Let me see. I'm going to kick myself in the head when I actually get there.
So I got, right, I'm working my way back here. I've got Daz Black. This is a thrilling bit of the podcast. Daz Black, Kez Evans, I beat Omar, Theodorus, Luke Cairo, Alex Parker, Logan Smith, a tag match. Tag match with Lucha DS.
It was on his Twitter as well. We're taking time, but I need to figure it out. I can't remember who it was. Oh my god, I'm going to kick myself. No.
Okay, he's all got his Twitter up as well. Again, this is all staying in. Us doing research on who you beat.
It was BT Dunn.
Oh, yeah. All right. Okay. Yeah. He's announced. Yeah. Rematch.
How
did the first match happen? Oh, that may be one of the tapings that has not come out yet. That's possibly.
Spoiler.
Possibly it. Oh, well, sorry. By the time this goes out, it would have happened. So it's fine. It's absolutely fine.
I'm pretty sure they beat him. And I was like, oh my God, because is he like a former champion or something as well? So I'm like, I'm proud of him. Hopefully the rematch goes the same way.
We'll find those that are going live. They'll be passed by the time this goes out. But those that are going live, I'm sure it was a fantastic match, and Talon beat him again, and Talon lost, unfortunately. Again, delete is appropriate as you need to when you listen. So I think we covered everything. We've got the two sheep and one cow, which is the most important question, of course. Is there any now that you're actually making your way out in the world, and you've already said that you're just happy to take any bookings you want or that you're given. So with that being said, though, is there any destinations you want to get to in the next year? So we've got Pro 2, we've got Respect, you've done ICW. Yeah. What's next?
Still Fierce Females. I feel like that's probably one of the top and indefinitely Discovery as well. We had Alan come to the school and we'd done matches in front of him, which was really cool to kind of just like have it, and I was against Jason Reed, and I was like, oh my god. And then also we have his name's Greg, who goes by Maverick. He was also in the match, so it was a triple threat, and I mean, I did win. I'm just gonna put that out there. I did win. But it was cool to just kind of wrestle in front of him, because I mean, Discovery's always been like the one that I wanted to wrestle for eventually. So Discovery and Fierce Females are on the top of the list, and then back at ICW, but that's probably what everybody will say.
Of course, Discovery is they've got Emerson Jane. She's going by now. I'm trying to get used to saying that, because I know if I eventually interview her, I'll just call her the wrong name the whole time. So we've got them. We've got Martina, of course. So it's an opportunity to get in the ring with her. And they've just brought in Regina Rosendahl from Finland. So that's a whole. She kind of had the same similar, definitely not a similar background, but she's trained with men most of the time anyway, so there's a little bit of a common ground, although the episode that'll be coming out by with her. Her training facility was a lot different than FEWA. FEWA is a lot nicer, that's what from what I get. Is there anyone from FPWA that you think stand out? I've seen there's more females coming in. There's names, Beth Shorty, Daisy Jenkins.
Daisy Jenkins, yep. They're definitely, for the female side, they're definitely working their way up. I mean, Daisy Jenkins, she hasn't been training for super long. She kind of joined during COVID, so she had to wait for ages before she could actually make contact, but she started to have matches now, and with Beth Shorty as well, she's been there for quite a while, so it's fun to just see them actually have matches and stuff. And then we've also got a new tag team that have joined, which is Robbie Balfour and Ross Hunter, which they've just seen them when we have training matches, just seen them together and like their energy, and it's just crazy. And then we've also got Arthur and Bose, we've got Tommy Cartel, who's just filled with energy and he's just over the top. Then we've also got who else have we got? I mean, we have Maverick, he's not debuted yet, but he does the kids classes and stuff now that Omar's went away, me and him joining the kids classes, and it's just crazy to see that we've got who else do we have? Let me think.
Is it Frank Gallo?
Frank Gallo, you guys? Yep, Frank Gallo. Just honestly, they're all so amazing and they're all crazy, especially Frank Gallo. Like, he's just biting ropes and fingers and chicken wings and all that stuff. But I'd say all of them guys who are kind of like the group that I like to, that I'm probably the closest with, they all train really, really hard, and they're all definitely going to be somewhere in like the next year, every single one of them. And I bet all my money on that.
So you're in that weird position where you've started wrestling now, but you're in that coaching role as well. So I don't know whether when you're watching wrestling just on TV or just live now, that you've got kind of that two mentalities going at the same time, where you're watching going, yes, this is a really good match, and oh, that looks really good, I might be able to pass that on, or that could be tightened up a little bit more, even though you're like, oh, they've been wrestling a lot longer than I have. Is watching wrestling changed for you now that you're in that dual role?
I think it even changed when I started wrestling and can't help with kind of today's stuff. If somebody, although they're on like WWE, and there's definitely been a time when I'm like, oh, that doesn't look that good. Like, I've not been doing the Monday classes as much. I've kind of went from being a coach for Mondays to now taking Omar's spot on the Wednesdays. So now I teach the kids, and it's still, any information I take from watching stuff or listening to interviews or even for math classes to teach them before they come up to our class is great to just kind of take, because I mean, they're still young, they're like 12 and 13, which is the ones we can give proper information to, but we've got the little kids who just kind of run about, but they also take it really seriously. Like, we've got Captain Chaos, who goes by, he's in the kids classes, and he's honestly, he's so, so incredible. Like, we have time at the end and he'll pretend to be like Drew McIntyre, and like, I've even came from Van Damme and all that. It's just crazy to watch. And we've also got a little girl called Macy who's been training for not I think a couple of months, maybe a little bit longer, but she's just been incredible. So just seeing them at such a young age, at like 7 and 8, and they're actually probably better wrestlers than me already, I'm like, oh my god, it's crazy just to, at least I could say I trained them to some extent with the help of Johnny Lyons, of course. But
exactly. That's, I mean, much like myself, sitting when you're an ICW making the big time, going, I was the first one to interview her. You can sit back and watch these wrestlers go up, going, ah, well, they wouldn't be anywhere without me training them at all. That's the end of the day. When it comes to interviews, there's a lot of places I'll be trying to take your name about, because I want this. Like I say, I'm the first person to interview you, but other people can as well. Is there any places that you've wanted to, like, I know there's Ella J at Wrestling Gal, is there any podcasts that you want to try and jump on and speak to, Gaw TV, anywhere I can tag them in at the end of this, say that we mentioned them?
I think probably the two you mentioned are probably the ones that I would like to go on eventually. I'm pretty sure Ashley Vega's been doing a little bit with both of their kind of stuff, so I think it'd be cool to just, like, get and speak to some ladies and kind of just see what they've got to say. I think it'll be fun as well.
Absolutely. All right. So that's fine. We've mentioned them, so I can add them at the end saying we talked about this. They're gonna have to wait an hour to actually hear them speaking about it, but that's fine. That's hits for me. So we've gone through what's coming up. Your Pro 2 respect. Have I missed anything? Is there any matches that you've got coming up that haven't have been announced as yet, but they will be in the next week or so?
No, they are the only ones that I've got this year. I don't have any for next year either, but I'm hoping to get a lot. My goal was just to debut this year, so getting to be booked for 3 matches is just like exceeded my expectations so much. So 3 matches before I turn 18 is just like crazy to me, and it's just great that I've actually got to wrestle. Even if my career stopped at the end of the year, I know that I've still debuted and still done 3 matches before I'm actually old enough to buy alcohol. So. I don't even like alcohol, but...
And you can search your name on the WWE Network and it comes up with a match. That's pretty yep. cool at yep. the end of it as well. Well, that's great. So if people are saying, well, 3 matches booked, but we want to book you for more. Before I do that, just one last mention of for your dad. You mentioned that he's already got your heel gear in mind. What's the most outlandish idea he's given you that it's hit the reject pile?
Whenever he's just like, he likes to have like, you have a beer and then they'd be like, you have to post this, you have to say this about something, you have to, like, trying to kind of get me to start like feud with people. It's like, right, no, you have to actually let me get, this is even before I debuted, so I'm like, you have to actually just let me like get somewhere first. But he's come up with a couple like cool hangs, or I'm like, oh, that's cool, but we could change it to this. There's some stuff honestly, he kind of likes to, it doesn't say too much like stuff that gets in the reject pile, because we think the same, but like I'm just like a younger female version of him. So but definitely when he's got to be drinking him and he's like, you have to tag this person, call him, I'm like, no, we're not doing that.
It's just at Stephen McMahon, call her a bitch, you know, just that'll kick off a big storyline. That's no, maybe not. Yeah. Okay, so that's fine. So we'll wrap up then. So people are going 3 matches. By the time this goes out, two of them would have happened. Of course, ICW as well. When they want to go, now we need to get Harmony Skye on my show, but before the end of the year, how can people get in contact with you? What's your social media?
It's Harmony Skye for Facebook, and I'm pretty sure it's Harmony Skye 03 for Twitter and Instagram. My email is in my Instagram bio for any inquiries. If anybody wants to do anything whatsoever, it's in my bio for Instagram.
Within reason, or we should really kind of put that by the end, because you know.
Or I'll just put it in the junk pile.
Yeah.
I'll just ignore it.
Wrestling fans are weird, but I don't think you probably would have encountered too many so far, but. No. Your time will come, I'm sure. Great. Thanks for taking the time to speak to me again in our quick catch up. And who knows, by time in 12 months' time, you would have wrestled everywhere, and I'll have a belt on you, and I'll be like going, oh, can we get a catch up? You'll be like, nah, I'm too big time now. I've done.
No, I'll come back. I'll come back. It'll be a tradition. I'll come back every single year, and I'm going to hold that. I'll hold that to you.
I'm writing that down. So that's a verbal contract. For anyone that is listening, that's it. It's definitely happening. In 1 year's time. One point, we'll get you on the Halloween episode, because we've just missed out again. And we'll because mind you talking about it outside of the recording when I said it might have been the Halloween episode. You were like, oh, I was going to decorate. I was going to get the place all done up. So
that's it. Yeah. My dad's birthday as well, though. So. I like Halloween anyway, but he doesn't really like it that much. But I think he's warming up to the idea of Halloween now. Now that we're no trick or treating and taking his time away for his birthday. But I love Halloween.
You have a couple of drinks and think of some Halloween gimmick ideas for you. That's all good. So even though it'll be like 6 weeks before Halloween, I'll also hold it that our next year, next chat, will be for the Halloween episode next year, and that'll be
feasible to have it. I've even got Halloween nails on, so I'm dedicated to it.
We're definitely doing it. But great. Thank you very much for taking time to speak to me again.
No problem. It was great. Thanks.